Hello all, very good morning. So we are discussing regarding the sampling and sampling techniques that were used in the nursing research. So in previous class we have seen different types of terminologies and what is the sampling process and types of sampling techniques. So in this class I would like to discuss you what is probability sampling technique. So coming to the probability sampling technique, so if you see in types of sampling techniques, we have probability sampling technique and we have non-probability sampling technique. Probability sampling technique, it has a special word which is called as randomization. So here in randomization, everybody have the equal chance. You can be selected, either I can be selected. If the population size is like 100 samples, in 100 samples everybody have chance to get selected as a sample. Whereas in non-probability, here the researcher has the power to select the sample. So the researcher can decide whether the person has to be taken into the sample or not. Whereas in probability sampling technique, everybody have equal chance and researcher cannot decide whether the sample has to stay in the study or not. If the inclusion criteria is meeting there, the sample can be selected as a study. So we'll discuss the probability sampling technique now. So coming to the probability sampling technique, so it involves what? Random selection of the elements mainly. So here randomization, what is this randomization means? Everybody have the equal chance. So out of 100 population, so the method, it could be lottery method. Okay, so when it could be simple randomization method, so here it could be computer method, it could be table method. So you also can be selected as a sample, I also can be selected as a sample. Here every subject in the population have equal chance to be selected in the study as what? Sample. So probability sampling technique, it is mainly used to enhance the representativeness of the selected sample of the study. So whenever you are selecting a person from the definite population, he represents the entire population of the study. So in probability sampling technique, the chances of systemic bias is relatively less because subjects are randomly selected. Here in non-probability, the researcher has the power to select the sample, but in probability sampling technique, the researcher cannot decide whether the person can be selected as a sample or not. So the sampling frame that was made and the sampling technique that was used during the selection process will have clear impact in the probability sampling technique. So what are the features here means? So the advantage is random sample is absence of both systemic and sampling bias. So you can, so whenever you are using the random sampling technique, both systemic as well as the sampling bias, both can be avoided and the researcher cannot decide whether the sample can be selected or not. So if random selection, if it is done very properly, so the sample that is selected, it will represent the entire population. So as we are discussing the features, both systemic as well as the sampling bias can be avoided. So minimal, if it is there, if you are doing correct sampling technique, means whenever you are choosing the particular probability sampling technique, if you do correctly, if you select the sample correctly, systemic bias can be eliminated as well as sampling bias can be eliminated as the sample is chosen randomly. Here in this probability sampling technique, everybody will have equal chance to get selected as what? Sample to the study. So here it is a technique wherein the samples are gathered in a process that gives all the individuals in the population equal chances of being what? Selected. Here in this, the researcher must guarantee that every individual has an equal opportunity for the selection, and this can be achieved only when the researcher is utilizing what? Randomization. So coming to the probability sampling technique, so we have different types as I am discussing. First one, we have simple random sampling technique. What it is? It is simple random sampling technique. So it is one of the most pure and basic process of sampling techniques in probability sampling technique. So here the entire population has equal chance of being selected as what? Subject. So whole process, it is done in what? Single step. It does not include multiple steps, it will include a single step. So here there is no need of two essential prerequisites to implement. So the population, it must be homogeneous, and the researcher must have list of elements or members of the accessible population. Nothing but here mainly we must have some kind of requisite, nothing but inclusion criteria and exclusion criteria, and he should have the exact number of population who are accessible for the study. So here the list of the subjects of the population is done in the sampling frame, and a framing pattern is drawn using the following method. So first one is lottery method. So what is this lottery method in this sampling technique means? First one is what we are discussing, what simple random sampling technique. In that we have lottery method. So in lottery method, first suppose if I want to select like five students for my study, the class strength is like 50. So what I will do, I will choose, everybody will have equal opportunity. What I am doing, I'm keeping like you are selected, you are not selected in a particular jar, and I'm making them to pick a piece of paper using the lottery method. So whenever they are taking, if it can come to anyone, means you need to prepare what, five selected slips and 45 rejected slips. So what I am doing in the lottery method, I am not touching these 5 chips, I am mixing all these 5 selected slips and 45 rejected slips, and I am making every student to choose their slip on their own. So when they are selecting their slip, the students who get the slip of selected, they will be chosen for the study. So here everybody are given the equal chance here. If you select the selected slip, simply you will get into the study. If you are selecting the rejected slip, you will be rejected out of the study. This is what the lottery method means. So we are making the sample to get into the study on their own. All 50 students have equal chances. If they select the select slip, definitely they are into the study. If they select the rejected slip, definitely they are out of the study. So this is what the lottery method means. So here, as we have written like 5 selected slips and 45 non-selected slips or rejected slips, all the 45 non-rejected slips or all 45 rejected slips, they must be kept back in the container, and the people who got selected slips, they will be kept with them. Simply we can select them as what, sample. So this is what is called as sampling technique. Second one is the use of table of random numbers. The use of what, table of random numbers. So this is one of the most common and accurately used simple random sampling technique here. So random tables are present in several numbers, in rows and in columns. So the researcher, he prepares a number list, then he blindfolds them, and he will ask them to choose particular number from the random table. So when they select the number, the selected number will be kept in the sampling study, and the non-selected number will be rejected from the study. The same procedure. So this is also same like the lottery method. So the same procedure you will repeat until you get the desired number. For example, same 5 students you needed, out of 50 students, we will blindfold each and every student, and you will ask them to select the random number. So when they are selecting the inclusion number, if they select, you will take it into the study. If they are not selecting, you will exclude from the study. So you will conduct the study until you get what, desired. So however, when they are selecting, if the repeated numbers are coming again and again and again, simply you can ignore them and you can go to the next numbers until you get the desired number of subjects that has to be achieved. Next one is the use of computer. Simply you will use the computer, you will enter the data of the population, and you will leave the work for the computer. When the number is large, mostly the computer will decide what numbers can be selected for the study. So for the population with small numbers, it is advisable to use the first method. What is the first method? Lottery method. But if the population has many members, simply you can go for computer-aided random selection. What are the advantages? Means it is most reliable and unbiased method, and it requires minimum knowledge of the study population and free from sampling errors. Coming to the disadvantages, so need up-to-date and complete list of all members of the population. It is expensive and somewhat time-consuming, and lots of procedures need to be done before you attempt the sampling process. And next type of study that we are going to discuss is stratified random sampling technique. So it is a simple random technique, you will use it in the homogeneous population, whereas Whereas the stratified random sampling technique, it is used in the heterogeneous population. So here the researcher, he will decide, he will divide the entire population into homogeneous population, that means subgroups, and he will randomly select the final subjects and proportionally from their different subgroups. So here the subgroups can be divided based on their age, gender, religion, socioeconomic status, diagnosis, education, geographical region, or the type of institution or type of care or type of registered nurses or nursing area specialization, site of care, etc. Simply you can select them, means simply you can, the heterogeneous population means the population is not homogeneous. Here there are different types of elements that are involved in a particular population, and you want to study different types of methods there. You want to bring out different types of points. So what you will do, you have to make that heterogeneous population into homogeneous population. So we will mainly in random stratified random technique, it is mainly divided into two types. First one is proportionate and second one is disproportionate. Proportionate and disproportionate stratified random sampling technique. So proportionate stratified random technique. So for example, if you see here a proportionate, so here it depends upon the size of the population. It depends upon what? Size of the population. So here the sample size of each stratum in this technique is proportional to the population size of the stratum when viewed against the entire population. Nothing but here, for example, we are discussing the proportionate. We are discussing what? The proportionate. We have like 100 students in one class, 200 students in one class, and 300 students in one class. So we are taking the half of the population. We are taking what? Half of the population. So what we will do? Proportionate. So since they are 100 in number, you will take 50 students from here, and since they are 200 in number, you will take 100 students from here, since they are 300 here, you will take 150 students here. So half of the population is being selected here. So in order to give you a clear example, we have like 300, 200 and 100. So we have like 600 total population. We have like 600 total population. So in this 600, what we have done is we have separated them according to their years. So from first BSc we have like 100 students, second BSc we have like 200 students, and third BSc we have like 300 students. So totally we have how many number of students? 600 students. Out of this 600 samples, I need like 300 samples for my study. How many samples I need? I need like 300 samples for my study. So as I am choosing the proportionate, since the first BSc students are 100 in number, so out of 100 students, I will select 50 numbers for my study, and second BSc students are 200 in number, so out of 200 I am selecting like 100, and third BSc are like 300 in number, so I am selecting like 150. So 150 plus 100 is like 250, 250 plus 50 is like 300. So 300 samples is achieved. Since they are 100 in number, I am taking 50 from them. Since they are 200 in number, I am taking 100 from them. Since they are 300 in number, I am taking 150 from them. Means proportionate, depending upon their size. Since they are 100, half of the population is taken into my study. 200, half of the population is taken into my study. That is 100. If it is like 300, half of the population is taken for my study. So this is proportionate based on the sample size and based on the sample population. And next one, if you see the example here, so population size is like 100, so sample fraction is half, so half of the population is selected for my study. Here the sample population is like 200, sample fraction is half, so 100 people are selected for the selected as a sample for the subject. Here the sample population is 300, fraction is half, so we are selecting 150 for the study. So this is proportional stratified random sampling technique. Next one is disproportionate stratified random technique. So here this is another subtype. So the sample is chosen from each stratum and it is not in proportion to the size of the total population in the stratum. So we are not considering the size of the population. We are not considering the size of the population. So what we are doing here, if you check here, even though the size of the population is increasing higher and higher and higher, what I need here is like, I need only like 150 samples for my study. So despite of their population size, even though they are 100, I am selecting 50 students. Even though here the number of students is 200, still I am selecting the 50 students. Even though number is like 300, I am selecting the 50 students here. So we are not focusing on what? We are not focusing on what? The size of the population. proportionate sampling technique, in proportionate sampling technique, here the sampling fraction is remaining safe. No matter what is the population size, no matter the population size, the sample fraction is remaining safe. So half we are selecting. Whereas in disproportionate, we are not bothering about the population size. We are mainly bothering about the sample size. So you want 50 students from first year BSc, 50 students from second year BSc, 50 students from third year BSc. You don't bother what is the total size of the population. Despite of their 100, 200 or 300, we will take only 50 students. So here opportunity, out of 100 students, half of the students are getting opportunity. Out of 200 students, the only 1 by 4 students are getting opportunity to get selected in the study. Out of 300 students, 1 by 6th population is only getting opportunity to get selected as sample for the study. So this is what disproportionate stratified random sampling technique. So hope you understood what is proportionate and what is disproportionate. In proportionate, based on the sample size, based on the population size, the sample fraction will be depending. So it doesn't change. If it is 100, if you want to select half of the population, 50 will be the final sample size. If it is 200, if the sampling fraction is half, 100 students will be selected. Whereas in disproportionate sampling technique, no matter what is the size of the population, the number is fixed there. Even though they are 1000, out of 1000 you will select only 50. Even though they are 100, out of 100 you will definitely select 50. What are the advantages? Means it ensures the representatives of sampling in heterogeneous population, and comparison is possible between the two groups. Coming to the disadvantages, it requires complete information of the population, large population is required, and the chances of faulty classification of the strata. And the third one is systemic random sampling technique. So what is the systemic random sampling technique? Means we are selecting the sample based on the number method, based on the number method. So here the number is randomly selected. For example, you have a population of 100 and the sample size is like 10. So what we will do, we will take the number of subjects that are there in the target population. What is the number of subjects that are there in the population? Means 10. And what is the size of population that you require? Means 10 samples. So here when you divide 10 into 100, 10 in 100, so you will, it will go like 10 times. So here the 10 will become, so he, for every 10%, one person is selected as sample. So every 10th person in the target population you are selecting as what? Sample here. So like that it will be. So every kth person, kth is equal to what is the number of subjects that are there in the population? 100. What is the sample size? It is like 10. So when you divide, you will get the answer like 10. So every 10th person in the 100 population is selected as what? Sample. For example, you need like 20 samples in 100 population. So when you divide it by 20, it will be like 5 times. The 100 will go in 20 for how many times? 5 times. So every 5th person in the 100 population will become as your sample. So this is what is called as systemic random sampling technique. What are the advantages? Means it is very convenient and simple to carry out, and distribution of sample is over the entire population. Coming to the disadvantages, it is less representative, and if subjects are not randomly distributed, and sometimes the result may be biased. Coming to the fourth stage or fourth type of sampling technique, you can call it as cluster or multi-stage sampling technique. So just imagine you want to select a sample from the entire Asia. So here a simple random technique or a stratified random technique or lottery method, it cannot be used because the population size is very large and the area is also very large. So during this time, what we are doing, we are going for the cluster or multi-stage sampling technique. So here we are using some kind of techniques here. Means we are dividing the areas into sampling units. Whenever you are dividing the areas into sampling units, so you will select these sample units by using stratified or simple random technique. So you can simply go for, you can write all the important city names. You can write all the important city names, means what are all the Asian countries that are there. So you will list out all the Asian countries and you will use a lottery method and you will pick some cheats from your sampling. So what you will select, you will end up in selecting some countries. So after selecting some countries, again you will go for the second method. So what in the second stage, what you will do, you will write all the important cities in this particular countries and you will go for the selection of the cities. Again after selecting the cities, you will write important hospital names and you will go for the selection, so that the multi-stage cluster sampling can be done. So this method is used in cases where the population elements are scattered over the wide area and it is impossible to obtain a list of all elements. So what you are giving here, you must give equal chances. So whenever you are writing country names, whenever you are writing any kind of city names, you have to write it properly. So geographical units are the most commonly used ones in this type of research. For example, the researcher wants to survey academic performance of high school students in India. So what he will do, firstly he will select what are all the important schools that are there in India. He will write the cities names. After writing the cities names, he will select the cities. After writing the selected city names, he will write definite school names. After selecting definite school names, he will pick the definite school and he will see the performance of the high school students. So coming to the types, so first one is one stage cluster sample. So as we are discussing, so here in one stage cluster sample, the researcher wants to identify the number of the performance of the high school students. So he will select the random clusters as sample. So in first stage, what he had done, he had taken the important cities. After selecting the important cities, he has selected certain number of schools. So after selecting the certain number of schools, he will select certain number of students, so that the second stage cluster sample can be achieved. So this is what is called as cluster sampling technique. In first stage, we are filtering using simple random or stratified random sampling technique. After that, you are going for second stage collection. After going for the second stage collection, you will select your sample and you will conduct your study. So what are the advantages? Means it is cheap, quick and easy for the larger population, and population parameters of the, they can be estimated by the sample size. What are the disadvantages? Means there is more chances for a high sampling error and chances of least representativeness due to the overrepresented or underrepresented cluster. Nothing but whenever you are selecting here, if your picking is not proper, if you are missing some important cities, when the equal chance is given to all the other cities, so automatically if this one city is not being selected, there are more chances of over representativeness or over under representativeness. So these are the advantages. And fifth one is, last stage in this sampling technique is like sequential sampling. This is the first one. So we have discussed mainly regarding the cluster sampling technique, we have discussed systemic sampling technique, we have also discussed proportionate and disproportionate sampling techniques. We have seen stratified and we have seen simple random sampling technique, and last one is sequential sampling technique. So what is the sequential sampling technique mean? So here it is different from the other methods that we have discussed. Here the sampling size is not fixed. Here the sample is selected until the researcher is satisfied. So here the investigator initially select small samples and try to make the inferences. So if the results that came are not appropriating to him, means if they are not acceptable to him, he will take some more samples and he will continue the study until he gets the desired number. For example, so a researcher, he wants to identify the number of patients, means the smokers and non-smokers who are getting the lung cancer. So what he will do, he will select some number of samples. So here subject selected for sample are like 20. So in this 20, smokers were 7 and non-smokers were 17. So the persons who are having the lung cancer, smokers are having, out of 7, 2 smokers are having lung cancer, and out of 13, one non-smoker is having lung cancer. So again, since he is not satisfied, he will increase the number of subjects. So he has taken 30 subjects. Out of 30 subjects, 18 are smokers and 22 are non-smokers. So out of 18, 5 smokers are having the lung cancer, and out of 22, 3 persons are having what? Lung cancer. So he is not satisfied at this point also. So what he has done, he has increased the sample size, and out of 50, 28 were smokers and 22 were non-smokers. So here 20 out of 28, 10 patients, 10 persons were affected with the lung cancer, and out of 22, only 4 persons were affected with the lung cancer. So, since if you see the numbers here, when they are compared, smokers are having more risk of lung cancer compared to the non-smokers. Compared to what? Non-smokers. So, when he is satisfied with the number, he will discontinue the sampling technique, or he will discontinue the study. This is the sequential sampling technique. Hope you understood. If you have any queries, please drop them in the comment box. So this is probability sampling technique. In next class, we'll discuss regarding the non-probability sampling technique. And if you have any queries, please contact me with my WhatsApp. And if I'm not clear with this, ask me to repeat it again. I'll definitely try to do my best. Thank you so much. Thanks for watching.